Well, welcome to the incredible address here in Washington, D.C. of 101 Constitution Avenue. We've got a great backdrop here. This is our Kemp Forum on Opportunity in the New Digital Economy. My name is Jimmy Kemp, and I love being able to sit down and engage with thoughtful people about the American idea. Our mission at the Kemp Foundation is to advance the American idea, to develop, engage, and recognize exceptional leaders who champion the American idea, which at its root is the human idea. As Speaker Paul Ryan likes to say, the American idea is the reality that the condition of your birth should not determine the outcome of your life. My dad always talked about the human idea being a universal concept that people have inalienable rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Obviously, the Declaration of Independence described that best. And that's a covenant that was made between our founders and the people. And it's really important to understand as we think about our country and issues that get down in the weeds, like technology and our digital economy, and how we're going to move forward as a leading nation in global economic growth, but having companies that can build the future, which is what America has always been. But as we think about that, it's critical to understand what underpins our ability to deliver that promise and hope. And we believe that that covenant of the American idea, best described in the Declaration of Independence, does that. In addition to that covenant, that promise, there are contracts, there's legislation. But anytime we get into the weeds of contracts, agreements, the legalities of how we're going to structure our society, it's really important to never forget the underpinning promise that this country provides, and that we're one nation under God. So the Kemp Forum series is a platform for the debate and discussion that provides a civil competition of ideas. And today we're excited about the people who have agreed to be here. And to start off, we want to thank the Internet Association, who's partnered in this event with us. And we've got lots of other folks who we will thank throughout the day. But we have Michael Beckerman with us from the Internet Association. We have Bret Swanson and Michael Mandel, who wrote a paper that you'll be hearing more about entitled The Coming Productivity Boom. And I need to apologize up front to Bret. We did make a mistake in your program. If you're looking at Bret's bio, it's not correct. It gives him a PhD, but I'm not sure that's correct. But it's actually somebody else's bio, and I don't know who, so don't ask me. It's from a previous Kemp Forum, and I appreciate your grace with us. But this is going to be a great day, lots of interesting discussions. We want you all to be involved in the conversation, we'll seek to do that throughout the day. So without further ado, I'm going to come up here and I'll moderate, but we're going to have Michael Mandel from the Progressive Policy Institute start off, and then Bret and then Michael respond as Michael and Bret talk. Oh, we're going to have Bret go first, talking about the coming productivity boom. And the reason why we're having this conference is in no small part because when I read their paper, the phrase that I love that embodies our values at the foundation is that their goal, and they believe that our nation's goal, should be to have economic growth more broadly shared. And that's the purpose, more broadly shared, connecting more people in a way that allows us to achieve our hopes and dreams. So Bret, with the apology for your bio being wrong, I do want to say that Bret started a firm called Entropy Economics. It's an economic consulting firm, and what a great name, Entropy Economics. It recognizes the reality that the world is not as it should be. And how do you study a dynamic world that has phenomenal potential, but also a recognition that it isn't as it should be, and we're trying to make it better. That's what all of us are doing when we engage in commerce make our life and the lives of others better. He's also a fellow. Are you a fellow at AEI? A fellow at AEI, and writes on the tech blog there regularly. Does lots of other things. But Bret, we're thrilled to have you, and get us started.
Terrific. Thanks so much, Jimmy. It's great to be at the Kemp Foundation. Thank you to the Internet Association. Great to be with my friend Michael Mandel. I think a lot of us might say that Washington could use a lot more of Jack Kemp these days in a number of different ways. So it's great to be talking about the topics of economic growth and opportunity here, especially as it relates to technology. You know, the last 10 or 12 years have been a tough time for economic growth. If we'd continued on the historical average path of economic growth, around 3% a year, the U.S. economy today would be nearly $3 trillion larger in output. Think about what that means in terms of incomes and jobs across the country. Now, there's no guarantee, there's no natural law that says that we get or allowed to grow 3% every year. It takes a lot of work and so forth. But we've had this sluggish economy. We've had sluggish productivity growth. There are a lot of reasons maybe why we've had this slump. Michael and I had sort of been thinking along the same lines for a while, thinking about just what are the sources of the sluggish productivity growth. But even more importantly, is innovation over? Is this the new normal? Is this all we can expect for the next decade, for the next two decades? You had a lot of people seeing the sluggish growth of the last couple of years. For instance, just one economist named Robert Gordon, who wrote a big influential book, saying that basically we shouldn't expect any faster growth for the next several decades. All the big ideas had been invented, most of the big technologies we've seen, and that, yes, we'll have incremental improvements, but nothing like the era of electrification, nothing like the Industrial Revolution. And that this is all we can expect. On the other hand, you have people at the other end of the spectrum saying that the real problem is that innovation is going so fast, there's too much technology, too many robots, AI, et cetera, taking all the jobs. So how can these two things be true? I think probably neither of them are exactly true, but we can reconcile them. And so what we looked at, we divided the economy into two big buckets. The digital economy, which is about 30% of the economy, that's tech, content, media, finance, professional services. And then the rest of the economy, which is about 70% of the economy. Everything else, healthcare, education, transportation, manufacturing, retail, logistics, et cetera. And what we found was that there's really a reason for these two diametrically opposed views of why some people see so little innovation, some people see so much. It's because the digital economy has been growing fast. It has been innovating. It has been rapidly increasing in productivity. So the companies of Silicon Valley, companies in media, companies in finance, we have seen lots of productivity growth. It's the companies in the rest of the economy that have really we've seen the concentration in the productivity slowdown. And the other thing that we found was that the companies that are the 30% of the digital economy make 70% of all information technology investments. The 70% of the economy, what we call the physical economy, makes only 30% of information technology investments. So what this led us to believe was that this 70% of the economy is, you could say, underperforming. It has not taken advantage of, exploited, leveraged the amazing power of Moore's Law and the internet and mobile technologies and the coming Internet of Things and so forth. And that if we could get healthcare and education and transportation and manufacturing and energy and retail and distribution to adopt the technologies that the fast-growing parts of the economy have already adopted, we could see a substantial productivity boom in the bulk of the economy that would produce overall economic growth closer to that 3% long run average, which means trillions of dollars in larger GDP growth, faster income growth, better jobs for more people. And the key, addressing Jimmy's point, is that because a lot of these digital industries tended to be concentrated on the coasts, California, New York, et cetera, that's why you saw a lot of growth and income growth, et cetera, in these areas, and why the rest of the country seemingly did not prosper as we saw all this innovation around us. But we think that as the rest of the economy, these other industries, these more traditional industries, now do leverage the Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, 5G mobile networks to propel transportation and logistics and healthcare into a new era, you're going to see more broadly based economic growth in more industries, in more firms, in more regions for more people across the country. That's the big idea of our paper. And we talked a lot about in the paper, not just the macro data, but also gave a bunch of examples of how particular industries could leverage these information technologies to do better. And Michael recently has been focusing on one area that I think is really exciting, where we're actually seeing this in action.
So let me just take a couple of minutes to sort of fill in behind Bret's really good presentation. First, I'm honored to be here at the Kemp Forum. It's very appropriate. I work at the Progressive Policy Institute. You know, you could basically say what we believe in is growth with an expanding winner's circle, which is exactly what you said. And it's important to sort of realize that when Bret and I started on this project, we thought of it as I don't even think of bipartisan, but it was, you know, we actually understood that we, despite being nominally on different sides of the political aisle, we could see that we shared a lot of views, and that there was actually, that it wasn't going to be difficult to write a piece together on this. Now, one thing that we're seeing right now is we're starting to see the penetration of information technology and the internet into the physical industries. Most importantly, the place where it's happening, the clearest place right now, is e-commerce. E-commerce, retail for many years was stuck in the mud, that people working in retail, brick and mortar retail, did the same thing that they were doing 20 years ago. They were reshelving inventory, they were watching for pilferage, they were checking people out. The jobs hadn't changed, and even worse, the wages hadn't changed. And then, you know, what happened is that e-commerce in recent years has transformed retail, has transformed logistics, and what's happened is that it's led to higher wages for workers. Workers in fulfillment centers earn 30% more than brick and mortar retail workers in the same area. It's resulted in better service for consumers. And it's resulted in growth in places that haven't seen it for 15 years. So it's spread out to places like Indiana, Ohio, Tennessee, Kentucky, and then it's kind of sort of spreading everywhere. And then the next step here is that the transformation of logistics has the potential for creating a manufacturing boom as well. Right? This is something that I sort of wrote about in a recent Wall Street Journal op-ed. And the fact of the matter is, as information technology permeates out to manufacturing, which oddly enough, it has not up to this point, the internet, you know, I was recently you know, you talk to manufacturers and you ask them if they have a digital strategy, and they kind of go, not really, okay? And so what's gonna happen is that as manufacturing gets transformed, we're gonna actually start seeing a growth in manufacturing at home as well. And you know, yesterday the Bureau of Labor Statistics released their 10-year projections of employment, and they've got manufacturing continuing to shrink. That's just wrong, right? As what we've learned from the e-commerce example is that applications of information technology, applications of the internet, don't cost you jobs, they actually increase jobs. That's what we've seen in e-commerce. E-commerce has generated many more jobs than have been lost in brick and mortar. I'm gonna stop right here to sort of give, you know, to you know, I think that we've kind of said enough. If you want to sort of learn more, you can go look at, if you just do a search for the coming productivity boom and Bret and my, or my name, you will find 10,000 copies of this document on the internet. This is an optimistic view of the future, and actually, since we put it out in March, there's been just a tremendous amount more that we've done on this, and that this is what I think what we're going to see is that this is actually, we've passed through the nadir, okay? We've passed through the pendulum. We've had quite a few years that were not good, and I think we're sort of heading on to a bunch of years that are going to be very good.
So, Michael, the optimistic coming productivity boom obviously is significantly impacted by the members of the Internet Association. How do you react to that? I'm guessing it's going to be positive, but can you add to what they're saying and give your perspective?
I mean, first of all, I think this is a very interesting and timely conversation, but it's one that we're still in the very early days. And so, you know, as they're talking about digital economy and parts of the economy that are not yet there, I'm confident that, you know, maybe the next time we have this conversation, it'll just be the economy, and you'll understand that the digital internet aspect of it penetrates everything in a positive way that has increased productivity, more competition for individuals, better quality of life, higher wages, all these positive things as the digital internet economy seep into the rest of the economy and become a standard part of it. But we are in the early days. I think largely when you look at some of the data, a lot of the positive impacts haven't yet been reflected there because some of the questions are being asked are maybe 20th century economic questions. And as you're looking at traditional industries like transportation, certainly that's one where, I mean, how many people came here in a traditional taxi versus Lyft or Uber? Everybody probably takes Lyft and Uber. So that's a one area where that's an industry that hasn't changed for many years and now is very much digital and is creating opportunities for people all over. The same thing is happening for healthcare, manufacturing maybe will be a slower one. Education, I think, is going to be the next wave also of improvement for everybody. And on the question of winners everywhere in the economy, a lot of the winners that are right in front of our face, it's so obvious that you don't see it. In every state across the country, in every single community, there are small businesses in traditional industries from retail to others where they're able to create a global business or compete with some of the bigger players in ways they weren't able previously because of efficiencies that exist in the digital economy from advertising to reaching consumers to so many other things. And I think being able to take a very local previously business and put it on a global scale because of the digital internet economy is something that is gonna be incredibly transformative for us and people in every single state.
So I worked with my dad from 2003 to 2009. We had a consulting company called Kemp Partners. And in 2007, I remember dad wrote a piece on the idea of taxing the internet and internet companies. And he started it off by quoting, I think his favorite president, certainly one who he knew best, President Reagan. And President Reagan said that government tends to, when it sees something move, tax it. If it keeps moving, regulate it. And if it finally stops moving, subsidize it. That cycle is obviously one we don't want to perpetuate. And that was the basis for my father's argument to not tax the internet and the commerce that's being generated from that. Obviously, that was 2007. We've got lots of issues today around this. Where do you three look at where the potential is going for the internet to do a lot of positive things and be at the core of economic growth? Where is policy holding back the innovation that stands to provide so many jobs and such opportunity?
Yeah, just to lay out the amazing story of the last 20 years. So over the last 20 years, we've had about $1.6 trillion in investment in broadband networks, fiber optics, mobile broadband networks. The companies from Silicon Valley and elsewhere now are making enormous tens of billions of dollars of investments in building the cloud infrastructure, building these data warehouses that serve all of our apps. So this has been a tremendous story of beginning to build this infrastructure. But now for the next era where we want these technologies to go into all these other sectors, one, I think we need to maintain a lot of the good policies that we've had in this area, which basically said, you know, yes, invest, we want you to go for it, experiment, try new things. But we're going to have to think about some policies, for example, for healthcare. Data provides huge opportunities in healthcare, but it's a tricky subject because of the privacy concerns in healthcare, right? So how do we get the innovation that a data-driven healthcare system can give us while protecting consumer privacy? So getting that balance right, that's one among many questions. You know, there are going to be a host of policy questions concerning driverless cars, autonomous vehicles. We're working on that. I think we want to, my view, is err on the side of innovation. This is a sector that has been tremendously successful. It's spreading opportunity. I think the bigger risk is that we step in and close off opportunity. Not to say there aren't going to be tricky issues. The other thing that I'll mention is I think tax reform is really important here. If you've looked at the financing mechanism of tech has been has enjoyed a huge venture capital market, right? And then even though the IPO market has been closed down, they can startups can go sell to the big Silicon Valley companies. The rest of the economy, manufacturers, companies across the middle of America, the last 10 years, financing has been tough, bank loans, and there's been no IPO market. I think tax reform will be especially important for companies that have lower margins and don't have that sort of venture capital basis.
I'm just going to say a word at this point about competition policy, which is going to be one of the areas that is going to be heavily fought out in the 2018 election and the 2020 election. And I think we have to be really careful to make sure that we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater here. The way that I think about it is, if we're going to do competition right, policy right, you look for the industries, you sort of judge the different industries on what sort of price increases they have and what sort of productivity increases. And if you really want to eliminate the bottlenecks in the economy, you look for the industries that have been increasing their prices and have slow productivity growth. And that's not the internet companies, okay? And I think we have to kind of think about this in a kind of a neutral sense of what are we trying to accomplish? Well, we're trying to get the economy moving. All right, let's actually sort of take a step back and sort of assess the different industries on a neutral scale and decide which ones are a plus for the economy and which ones aren't.
Yeah, I think clearly when you're looking at this sector as probably the most dynamic sector of our economy, fastest growing, we're certainly in the keep moving phase as you laid out, and we want to make sure that continues. And I think there are certainly lessons, policy lessons to be learned when you look at some fundamental pieces that we've had in place here in the United States that has allowed this growth to happen and allowed so many dynamic companies to be born and grow here in the United States, where it's an incredible competitive advantage for us as we look to the future. I would say the internet's a great American export. And so we want to make sure that we don't change that or break that by changing some of the core fundamental policies that we have here in the United States that don't exist abroad. And so when you look at Europe and how the slow growth they've had, and that it's hard probably to name a whole lot of internet companies that are born and growing in Europe or other parts of the world, what is it that we have here in the United States, right? We've gotten some things right on IP policy, on things like Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act, other policy that we've had that have allowed such innovation to exist here in the United States. And as we're in the keep moving phase, if we allow ourselves to get to the stop moving piece, I think we'll be in big trouble and we'll lose a lot of the advantages that we have in the United States that don't exist abroad.
Yeah. Does anybody in the audience have anything that they would like to ask this panel? If you do, speak up. If not, I'm going to keep going. Raise your hand if you do. Right here. Yes, Rick Kessler. And I'll repeat the question. Right. How do we make sure the unbelievable opportunity that we've talked about? How do we get the inclusion of populations? So these regulations written years ago, how do we expand the people who are able to benefit from them? And I know one of those populations that Rick is talking about are disabled folks who the internet and automation, all the things that our technology companies have done, think about the opportunities that they've provided them, but not just disabled, minority communities. How do we expand that opportunity and think about that so that it's more broadly shared, as you all write about?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's clear that technology, particularly digital internet technology, is a great equalizer where it will allow disadvantaged communities, however you want to define that, to be able to compete with others and have advantage that they don't ever have. Even like a very simple thing, using the taxi example of being able to call a ride to you to meet your whatever needs you have. But also, like I mentioned, communities, as long as you have an internet connection and you're in anywhere in the country, you can build a global business and a business that can compete with anybody, and that wouldn't be possible without a number of these benchmark laws that we have on the books and without the digital economy.
So we're starting to see the broadening right now of who's benefiting. What happened is that for many years it seemed like the most beneficiaries were on the coast and higher educated people. And recently, it's been broadening out to other parts of the country. It's been broadening out to people with a high school education. And I think that the sense of inequality that people had, growing inequality from tech, is actually starting to reverse at this point. I think this is really important as part of a natural process. It's part of a process of the internet benefits broadening out to the physical industries. And it's going to take a while for the politics and the perceptions to catch up with the reality, but it's actually happening right now. So we're in the interesting phase where when I talk to reporters and they say, e-commerce is destroying all these retail jobs. And I say to them, they weren't paid very much. They're getting much better paid jobs. And the growth, we're putting in place these projects that are adding jobs that have not seen projects of this size for 10 or 15 years. And they say, oh, wow. Okay. And it just takes time for people to understand that the pendulum is swinging in a different direction at this point, is swinging towards a broadening. And this, right, you sound look a little bit skeptical at this point, but it's in the data, and it's going to be increasingly in the data going forward.
Yes, Gator. Keep it short, because I've got to repeat everything that you're saying.
Okay. I'm a business owner in the manufacturing and industrial services.
So we've got a manufacturer here, yes? Oh, good. There's a microphone. That's what we needed.
And over the last couple of years, what we have seen is exactly what Michael and Brett are talking about, where due to, in part, implementing new information technology, I've seen productivity growths of 25, 30, 40% per employee.
Sign that man up.
In the niche, in the niche businesses that I own, and what it's transforming into now is the opportunity for me to pay, obviously, my employees more money because of those productivity growths. So I think that productivity transformation is starting to hit more traditional markets, but it's been a long process and one that's only at its very beginning.
That's great.
Yes. Jeff Phillips from Reserve Officers Association.
I walked here.
Great.
That's a great location.
Right. How does technology increase employment, not just productivity? We get it, because there's displacement, yada, yada, yada.
Let me do a really fast version of this. Remember Henry Ford's plant. Henry Ford's plant was far more productive than any of the competitors. It also hired a lot more. And what happened was is because they reduced prices. Now, I don't want to kind of go into the details here, but if you look at the data for manufacturing over the last 20 years, okay, in a lot of ways, productivity has not gone up in manufacturing, correctly measured. What's happened is that there's been a lot of changes. There's been a lot of it's not as progressive as you think that it is. And you really want to sort of think about moving towards being able to have local manufacturing facilities, not having to sort of ship things 10,000 miles as the technology gets better, okay? And so what happens is you can sort of provide a lot of your needs from plants that are closer by, so you don't have to invest so much in transportation. And so, you know, it's going to be a very different world that we live in, but remember, history is on the side of productivity gains means growth.
I want you to ask the last question. Go ahead. Yes, there is a mic. It's coming.
Hi, I'm Patrice Nwuka with the Independent Women's Forum. Interested in the education skills gap for the jobs of the future. So, I mean, we're seeing lots of, particularly women who are in positions that are already being automated and eliminated. You know, what is it going to take for them to be able to have the jobs that are running this machinery and technology in these industries that are not necessarily fully full of technology yet?
So if you look just at fulfillment centers, these are industries where they require a high school education, but the main thing they require is a comfort in working with machinery, okay? And so I don't see a gender gap there, okay, in the end, which is that if you're comfortable working with technology next to technology, sort of tech-enabled, then it's a job that's available to you. Now, I'm not going to get into the deep questions about what people prefer and what they don't prefer, because frankly, I don't think that's really important. I think in the end, if people have good jobs available to them, they're going to take them. And it's not ones that, you know, we're not talking about things that are coders or anything. We're sort of talking about the whole range of jobs.
That's a great question. And it's something that we all need to do better and also emphasize, you know, as companies and as, you know, the education system to make sure that young people today have the opportunities and skills they need for the economy of today and tomorrow. And it's something that we at the Internet Association have invested in heavily and worked on, from STEM and computer science programs with after-school programs for middle school kids and high school, and something that just a few weeks ago we worked with the White House on an initiative to create computer science funding for K-12, both on a private sector pledge that we announced of over $300 million from a group of companies, and then also on the public sector side. And so it's something that we need to really emphasize and work on, and I think companies are taking it very seriously, and the government now is starting to do their part as well. So it's a great question.
And it's a great question to lead into our next panel on the future of work, what jobs will look like. I want you all to join me in thanking Michael, Bret, and Michael. Thank you, gentlemen. We really appreciate it. I want to thank for use of this facility, the Nelson Mullins Law Firm. We really appreciate being able to enjoy this view while we talk about the future of work, the digital economy, how to get economic growth more broadly shared. And one of the companies that has been at the forefront of changing the way all of us do whatever it is we do every single day has been really involved in helping us put this together. And we have from Google Lee Carosi Dunn, who's a good friend, and she's the head of White House Outreach at Google. She worked on the Hill for many years, and it's critical that we have people who understand the way that government works or doesn't work at the companies that are on the forefront of innovation. Google is certainly thinking about all these issues, and to introduce our next panel, please welcome Lee Dunn. Thanks, Lee.
Thanks, Jimmy. While I speak, I'll invite the panelists to come up. Next, we're going to have Secretary Acosta and Dan Brandt from Walmart, and Senator Ben Sasse. So Google is an IA member, and I am really happy to be able to have the privilege to introduce the next panel, not only because I really appreciate all the work that Secretary Acosta is doing to help our workforce and as well as Senator Sasse, but Google has a strategic partnership with Walmart, and Dan and I were just talking about it. So Google partnered with Walmart earlier this year using two products we have. One is Google Shopping Express. It's not deployed in every state everywhere yet, but it is here in the DC area. So instead of spending as much time as I do driving back and forth to Walmart to buy more diapers, more baby food, more toys, more milk, more bread, now I can go online anywhere I want, hopefully on the soccer field where I am with my kids, and order all that milk, bread, toilet paper. I know Senator Sasse has three kids, so I know you know what I mean, right? Yeah, a lot of toilet paper. A lot of diapers in our days, right? And so, you know, this is where technology really is great, and this is where a partnership between a brick-and-mortar retailer like Walmart and a technology company like Google really comes into play, and Dan and I are really proud of it because we believe that we're saving Americans time, we're giving them better quality of life, and they're still getting the great products that they want from Walmart, and Google's enabling that. The second Google tool that we use to partner with Walmart is Google Home. And so I think a lot of you have heard about these new devices. Amazon has Alexa, Google has Google Home, where you can be there and say, man, I have zero diapers left for my child. Google Home, please order more diapers from Walmart, and they're delivered. So again, sometimes you don't even have to go to the computer. You can speak to the computer, and magically diapers and everything else is delivered to you courtesy of Walmart. So Dan and I are really proud to help sponsor this panel and this discussion, but we're really proud of the partnership between our two companies because it shows the new technology and the brick and mortar coming together to serve Americans' needs and give them better quality of life. So thanks, Dan. I kick it off to you.
Wonderful. Thank you. A big thank you to Jimmy Kemp and the Kemp Forum team for convening this discussion today. Jimmy, I hope that you and the forum never grow tired of talking about opportunity-oriented public policy and making that agenda lively and relevant as you do so well. So thank you. We may have a Senate vote coming up before too long, so we're going to move fast. It is a delight, though, to introduce two distinguished leaders in our national life, Senator Ben Sasse and Secretary Alex Acosta. I'm privileged to have been a colleague of both of these outstanding leaders many, many years ago. Very briefly, let me just introduce them. As you probably know, Senator Sasse has a doctorate in American history. He served for a period of time as a management consultant. He was part of the leadership team in the Office of Legal Policy at the Justice Department in Bush 43. He was
also known as Dan Bryant's chief of staff, but whatever.
This is true. He was also a chief of staff in the House of Representatives. He was then the assistant secretary for policy at HHS. He was president of Midland University, a small university in his hometown of Fremont, Nebraska, a university which, like many such educational institutions, is under distress. He came in and really presided over a remarkable turnaround at this institution, a period of growth and a variety of really exciting performance indicators under Ben's leadership. He is now the senator from Nebraska and, more importantly, a best-selling author. If you haven't yet read, more importantly, bought his book, The Vanishing American Adult, please do so. It's a remarkable book that's really been a catalyst for important conversation. Secretary Acosta, a successful attorney in private practice at Kirkland & Ellis, before he became a board member of the National Labor Relations Board. He was the Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights in the Bush 43 administration. He also served as United States Attorney for the Southern District of Florida. He then also pivoted to the academy and served as dean of the Florida International University Law School. Again, a remarkable tenure, turning around and really helping to elevate that educational institution. He was also chairman of a local bank, where again, he was involved in really helping to strengthen a crucial local institution. He is now the Secretary of Labor. Secretary Acosta, Senator Sasse, Thank you.
Thanks for having us. Thank you.
So this future of work digital economy conversation is very well timed, as all of you know. It feels like you can't walk two steps and not bump into this issue and hear a discussion and debate about this issue. What I did want to do, though, from the outset was to ask both the senator and the secretary to help put this in context. This is not the first moment where we can foresee ourselves moving into epical changes that will have upsides and downsides and that will have any number of disruptive effects. This isn't the first such moment. Senator, can you help place this moment, as we think about where we're going, in a historical context related to prior sweeping changes that affected the economy and society?
Yeah, that's fun. So first of all, good to be here. Thanks for moderating. Thanks to Google. I think we're here mostly because we love Jimmy Kemp and the Kemp Forum's focus on opportunity. But I think this panel also originated out of the fact that the three of us were having pizza a couple months ago. And Alex and I realized that we agree on a bunch of things and we differ on some things. And Dan said, let's take this on the road. So I will say, I think this city is always presentist. And it's sort of always obsessed with what can we accomplish in the next 6 months or 24 months in the legislative agenda. And one of the reasons why I think the city's often not very effective at thinking about near-term policy is because we don't have a historical context. So thanks for giving me this pitch. I think if we do the epical history, I think you've only had four kinds of economies in the history of the world, right? You had hunter-gatherers, you had agrarianism, not like Nebraska farming today, which is high-tech, but 10,000 years ago until 150 years ago, you didn't have job change in these kinds of worlds. You didn't have job choice. If you're a hunter-gatherer, or if you're a farmer from the beginning of time until 150 years ago, you have just becoming 8 or 10 or 12 years old and doing more of what mom and dad do or what grandma and grandpa do. You don't have specialization. Now Alex is presiding over a world where hyper-specialization is going to change. You know, every 24 months, people have to rethink, does their job still exist in a decade? And so I think the only way to anchor this moment is by thinking about industrialization. So I'm gonna come back to this, let Alex set the stage as well, but I think the analog for this moment is the moment of the end of the agrarian era and the rise of urbanization and industrialization, where job choice came into being and specialization. Now we have hyper job choice, hyper specialization, which is gonna happen multiple times in the course of a lifetime, and that's completely new in human history. So I think the analog to this is the industrial era and the progressive response to that, and we don't have the historical categories to anchor this moment yet in the same way.
Very helpful. Secretary.
So let me echo the thank you. It's wonderful to be here and to sort of take this discussion on the road. We actually started the discussion and didn't finish over dinner, and so great opportunity. Let me sort of pick up where Ben left off and sort of finish what I think is the thought. And so we have had change throughout human history, but the rate of change is so much faster today than it ever was. And if you sort of look, you know, to go from the hunter-gatherer to industrial, it took how long? To go from industrial to sort of what we call modern took a little bit, you know, less time. And as we progress, we're seeing change happening faster and faster. And so let me throw out some examples. The iPhone. How old's the iPhone? Any ideas? Someone really young in the audience back there. How old's the iPhone? When was it invented? Have you ever been without an iPhone?
Yeah.
Okay. So how long was it invented? Actually, about 10 years ago, right? We think of the iPhone as sort of, you know, part of us almost, or some kind of high-tech phone, yet it's relatively new. Uber, Lyft, Airbnb, these are all new inventions. They didn't exist before, so look at how much has been transformed in just under a decade. And if you sort of spin that out, whether it's a newer economy or not, we can debate what's the definition of new, but something that I don't think we can debate is it is an age of accelerating change where each cycle of change comes faster and faster and faster. And so we need to think ahead if we're gonna be ready. We need to have lifelong learners. And let me sort of touch on that, because as you have job choice and as the jobs change, the workforce needs to be ready to change with that. But I the one point that I would caution is, as we talk about lifelong learning, it's important to understand that lifelong learning and lifelong earning are not exclusive. And so we need to teach skills at the same time that we teach the ability to learn. And that is something that I think it's important to circle back to, because that is something that I think we're losing as we're focusing just on how quickly things change. Let's not focus on the fear of future change, but let's focus on what skills we need today as well.
Briefly, before we jump forward, thinking about this upskilling requirement, anything to learn from the transition from the industrial age to the information age? It happened iteratively, it was complex, but it happened. As we look back on that from the perspective of an historian, anything to learn as we now know we're on the cusp of this accelerating change, a change that is, to the Secretary's point, already underway. Any quick lessons to be learned?
Yeah, I mean, I think the anchor of human identity is, you know, your family, your friends, your sort of worldview. Do you have a theological or philosophical framework to make sense of death and suffering? And do you have work that matters? Sort of, you know, a number of us were at the AEI event last night, and Arthur Brooks talks all the time about meaningful work as one of the core drivers of human happiness. And it isn't, do I think I make enough money? Do I think at the end of the day my ankles or knees hurt, or that there's some annoying person three cubicles away who talks too loudly? Am I satisfied with the experience of my work all day, every day? But do I think my work matters? Am I needed in the world? And if those are kind of core anchors, it turns out that work anchors a lot of the other ones. Family structures are kind of derivative on work. Your local community is clearly derivative on work. And so I think the big analog to kind of 1870 to 1900 or 1920 was this last moment of disruption where work, again, when you were hunter-gatherers, even though you were mobile, you took your fourth and your sixth cousins with you. There was community that traveled with you. When you were in an agrarian village in New England during the colonial period, or Nebraska after the Homestead Act in the 1860s, 70s, 80s, your work defined the place where your community was anchored. What happened with the disruption of people leaving the countryside and moving to cities, both push and pull factors. So 86% of Americans live and work on the farm during the Civil War. 60% live and work in cities by World War II. That disruption is transformational. It happens inside 70 years. People thought America won't work when you move to cities, because you're going to have a disruption not just of your work, but of your community, and there's going to be anonymity. Your word won't matter. You won't have dense relationships anymore. There'll be all this anonymity, which will destroy community. And for a while, that is what it looked like. Like, maybe nobody in this room is going to defend prohibition as a policy, but we got prohibition because there really were drunk 15-year-old Irish kids everywhere in the streets of Baltimore and Philly and Boston and New York. There was the sense that anonymity was going to destroy community, and we had to figure out how to build new forms of social capital, and it happened in cities. But it just took a number of decades before you figured out what it looked like to have the density of community in urban ethnic neighborhoods. I think a huge part of what we're going through right now is we're hollowing out these local institutions as we go from mostly urban living to mostly suburban, exurban living, and work for the first time might not be the anchor of the home place. Obviously, our work and our home are separated in the factory era, but you still live near the factory. What's happening now as job duration gets shorter and shorter and community gets disrupted is people have less social support networks to think about how they get to meaningful work again. And now you're going to have to do that when you're 40 and 45 and 50. That's never happened before in human history. So to Alex's point about getting to a place where you think about reskilling and uptraining, that's happening at a moment where your local community network is also being disrupted. And so I think we need bigger categories to understand we're going to need new social capital and communal density again, but we don't know where that's going to come from. And so I think we're going to need to have sort of multi-decade thinking about what it looks like to find work that's new to somebody who's mid-career, which is a new thing, even as their local networks and support structures and community are disrupted.
Let me, if I could, take a slightly different tact. And we were at the same dinner last night, and Rabbi Sachs had I think it was he who raised a really interesting point, which is that, that Facebook has now changed their corporate motto from connecting people to creating communities. And on the one hand, I do agree that, that that our communities are being disrupted, but on the other hand, we have a real interesting opportunity now to use technology and other modern mechanisms to create these communities. And one of the challenges that, that we saw as we moved from industrial to information age is we had enough time for our government institutions to keep pace and to adjust the rules of the road. But what we're seeing now is we're seeing the demand for different working modalities change, but we're not seeing government keeping pace. And so most of our labor law is organized around a very traditional lifelong relationship between employer and employee. Well, less and less that defines the typical relationship. And for the younger folks in the room, you're going to have probably a dozen different employers as you go through throughout your life. More and more we're seeing individuals working in a gig economy where they may have multiple jobs or they may work from home. And so on the one hand, how do you create communities around that? And going to Ben's point, that needs to happen. If we're going to have a cohesive social compact as a nation, we need to figure out ways to create communities. And technology can be used to do that, not just to connect people, but to create communities. And there is a difference between having 200 Facebook friends and having 200 Facebook friends that you can really embrace that are there for you, right? But at the same time, government has an obligation to keep pace and to re-examine the rules that, that are used to regulate those employer-employee relationships that then impact on the ability of individuals to work in a modern system that can help create those communities. And I think one of the challenges is, can our institutions keep pace with the pace of change in the private sector?
Let me go there before we do. What's the average number of friends that someone has today, Senator Sasse, compared to 10 years or 20 years ago?
Yeah, so there's a lot of literature on loneliness as an epidemic. You have a bunch of public health folks who now define loneliness as the number one health problem in America. The average American in 1990 had about 3.2 friends. I mean this not as Facebook friends or Senate friends, my good friend from the state of X that I'm about to eviscerate in a debate. Like an actual Aristotelian friend, somebody that when they're happy, you're happy. When they hurt, you hurt. The way we love our kids, right? When my teenage daughters hurt, I don't choose to hurt, I just hurt because I love them.
You don't have to define what Aristotelian friend is. We all know that.
Well, when you say you have three, after Alex just mentioned 200 Facebook friends or 200 Facebook friends, the average American had 3.2 friends in 1990, 1.8 today, a halving of friendship in under 30 years. There's a rapid, massive hollowing out of a sense that people have anybody they can count on in a time of crisis. 40% of American adults say they have zero confidants, zero people that they talk about anything important with. That's devastating.
And so as we head into this period of disruption and downsizing and reskilling and so much change, it feels in many ways like the social capital that is required to help you manage through those transitions may itself be depleted. Let me ask, Secretary, following up on a comment you just made, how can government, federal, state, local, how can it, working within their own spheres of competence and together, help minimize the downsides and maximize the upsides of this future of work economy?
So, you know, I think government needs to take a serious look at what work looks like today and what it will look like in the future. And let's just mention, you know, gig economy, lots of folks talk about that. There is a very in-depth study currently underway at BLS within the Labor Department to try to quantify the gig economy. In 95, it was a certain size. In about 2005, it hadn't grown much, to the surprise of some, but we haven't really done an in-depth study in 10 years. And I don't know what the results are, but I'm gonna predict that from 2005 to today, we've had a massive change in the percentage of our economy that can be defined loosely as so-called gig. And so, have we re-examined our laws and our rules to incorporate that? And as this result of that study come out next summer, what are we going to do as an institution of government, both on the executive and on the legislative side, to say, when do we modernize the rules that govern the workplace? If individuals want to work in a gig style, are we going to accommodate that, or are we going to fight it? And that is something that that is sometimes hard, I think, getting legislation done. Takes a lot of hard work and takes some amount of time. But I would argue that it's something that, in the long run, we really need to do, because these laws need to change. No one thinks that today's economy is the way it looked in the 60s. Yet much of the rules of the road were set back in the 60s, and they need to be updated.
Or the 50s, 40s, or 30s.
Yeah, Senator. I want to underscore that point. So Alex has done a really important bit of work trying to nudge not just the executive branch and the rulemaking and regulatory processes, but the oversight and legislative committees in the House and the Senate to start thinking about this era of gig economy, or more broadly, the portable, mobile economy with this more rapid set of changes. And we are trying to run most of these social economic policies on a 1965 chassis. And nobody works in the same way. Average duration at a firm in the 1970s was 2.5 decades. Average duration at a firm today is 4 years and change. Right. So when you think about healthcare, when we have our healthcare debates, we tend to have big and important debates about level of government subsidy and federal versus state regulation, but very little of the conversation is talking about the number one driver of uninsurance in America, which is job change. When you ask the American people, why are there more uninsured people 30 years ago to 20 years ago, 20 years ago to 10 years ago, they say two things. They think there are either more, it's either pre-existing health conditions, we have more sick people, or it's socioeconomic status, we have more poor people. Neither of those things are true. We have more uninsurance in America primarily because we've had more job change, and if you have your employer be the basis of where you get your health insurance, then if you change jobs every 4 years, you have a 4 to 6 month period of uninsurance at the moment of job change. Well, that ends up meaning that 1/8 of the time, you're uninsured. Well, that's when you get the breast cancer diagnosis. That's when you have the car accident. And now you become the pre-existing conditions population of 10 and 20 years from now. And so we need health insurance, I would argue, more catastrophic than trying to have first dollar for everything, trying to sort of launder regular healthcare expenditures through an insurance marketplace, which we don't do in any other sector. We don't try to insure against the routine. But set that political debate aside, simply the question of whether or not you have portability in your policies is one of the biggest drivers of uninsurance. And the last big social economic policy change in America was 30 years ago when we fixed this problem for retirement. Right? It used to be that the assumption was you were going to have one employer for your life and you were going to have a defined benefit plan. And in the mid-late 1980s, we switched to a world where you have tax-protected 401ks that are portable across job and geographic change, because you're going to aggregate contributions from lots of employers over the course of a lifetime. So we've sort of figured it out on pensions, and that was the last big updating we did, and it's 30 years ago. Alex is trying to drive lots of those conversations in other places than just pensions right now.
So in addition to modernizing in key areas of policy and law, it feels like we'll do that, and it will already be potentially outmoded. It will be outdated. It feels like we need a political policy business framework that embraces the premise that we all have to be nimble in continuing to innovate as this pace of change continues to accelerate. What might that political policy business framework with nimbleness built in as a premise look like?
And so, Let me come at it from an unusual angle. The private sector is nimble because it has to be nimble. If you are not nimble, someone else will be. And as Google or Walmart will discover in a few years, you know, someone else can come in if you're not nimble and stay ahead of the curve. Government.
There have been a few others that have come in the last couple of years.
Yeah. Government has less pressure to be nimble. And so one solution to nimbleness is to allow, you know, for government to set frameworks, but then to allow individuals out in America to do what they do best, which is to decide what is best for themselves and their family, and adjust as conditions adjust. And so let me give you an example in a different context, which is education. The traditional model of education is you go to school and then you go to work. In this changing time, is that the right model? Or do we need to allow for you work, school, work, school, work, school, or simultaneous work and school? And so we're talking in the administration about apprenticeships and industry-recognized apprenticeships. And the key to there is earn while you learn. You can be working as a pharmacy tech and learning to be a pharmacist, both simultaneous with your employer working in partnership with the college so that you get the education that you need to progress within your career, and you're upskilling your career both for your personal benefit, for the benefit of your employer as well, and the employer is supporting that. That's a very different view of education, but an education that brings all the partners into it. One of the challenges is, are our educational institutions accustomed to that? Can they be nimble enough to break the traditional framework and adopt that? Another challenge is, are government institutions nimble enough? And so I'll throw out one idea. We have all these benefits. 529 plans, for example, are one benefit, where so many in this audience are probably saving for your kids' education through 529 plans. Do those provide enough choice and nimbleness to adjust to this growing economy? So we, I would argue, as a government, need to recognize the importance of individual choice in charting one's path going forward, because individuals are going to be more nimble than government.
Senator, a nimble public-private framework.
I would stay at education first, which is that we have a higher education model that is still kind of one size fits all, and that every degree program is 4 years. Most schools aren't differentiating based on price, by degree type, by discipline that you're studying, by whether or not this is a liberal arts background or whether or not you're doing a pre-professional degree. We need lots more pluralization in this space, right? So secondary education became a mass institution during industrialization. So at the Civil War, end of Civil War, less than 2% of Americans are high school graduates. By 1940, 78% of Americans are high school graduates. Today, it's low 80s. So it hasn't really changed in the last 75 years. But in the previous 75 years, when you left the farm and moved to the city, institutionalizing the basic awake hour experiences of 14 to 18-year-olds became the mass experience. We're now drifting to a place where we act like a mass experience of 18 to 22, usually 23, 24-year-olds. The average time to degree at most big state universities now is pushing 5.5 years. You're only getting a four-year degree. You're just paying for 5.5 years because the institutions are so lethargic. There's so little competition. But we're acting like it's a normal thing to treat every 18 to 20-something the same, and they're going to do this full-time, and later they're going to go work, and they'll work till the end of their days. Neither of those things are true. So we need lots more pluralization of higher ed. Some of that needs to come from the policy side, but the reality is you're probably only going to get it if the private sector, in terms of employers and lots of social enterprise, venture capital, venture philanthropy entrepreneurs, things like what the Khan Academy is doing, disrupt this model by looking at new opportunities that consider hybridization and differentiated place, because you're not doing a full-time 18 to 22-year-old for everybody in a way that's very effective.
And let me put some numbers around that. I was in a state recently, and I was speaking to some educators. And this is a state that's doing incredibly well. Among the large states, it is number two in the nation. And in advance of that, I like to look at stats. And so I pulled up the stats. And as I said, number two in the nation, so doing really well, right? 67% of students that entered college graduated within 6 years. How many of you in the audience would have expected a graduation rate of 6 years of 67%, and that's number two in the nation for a state university system? Now, of those 67%, let's call it two-thirds to make my math easy in a second, how many had a job that paid $25,000 or more within a year? And that was a really good stat, too. It was 66%. So two-thirds times two-thirds is four-ninths, right? And so less than...
Hold on, checking it.
he's the PhD.
In math.
Less than half the students that started college graduated within 6 years and had a job that paid $25,000 or more. And that is a successful state college system, right? So what do we really call success in higher education? And so I think a really interesting thought experiment is ask yourself, whatever state you're from, do you know how many students go to your state university? And I bet you many of you do. Do you know how many graduate? Very few of you will know that figure. Do you know how many of you have how many of those had jobs? And I bet you very, very few in the audience or anyone who might be watching know that figure. So are we holding our educational systems accountable for output or input? Are we judging them by what's your enrollment and what's your fundraising figure? Or are we judging them by, are you graduating students that get jobs? And which matters more? How many people you can get through the door or how many people get out and hold jobs? And I think that that's a very basic question that we need to ask as we look at our educational institutions, and are they preparing this generation for the future?
Thank you. Unfortunately, we have Ben for two more minutes. He has a vote. He has to run. Any last comments? And if you would, Senator, we talk about community colleges, vocational education. You referenced 18 to 22. You even referenced high school. Any quick final thought about the imperative of innovation actually working its way down into high school as we think about upskilling, different kinds of skilling, and future of work?
Yeah, I mean, I'll make a brief comment, not to ride a hobby horse, but on adolescence as it's done in America right now. We are not thinking enough as a people about what is great about adolescence, but what the risks are of perpetual, endless adolescence. So adolescence is a category that's really only about two millennia old, and it's this idea that pre a concept of adolescence, there were dependent children and independent adults, and in every way, you hit this marker where you transition from childhood to adult, and you were supposed to become an adult in every way. So you hit puberty, used to come at 14, 15, now in most sort of first world nations, it comes at 12 or 13. But it used to be, you got to be 14, 15, and your body went from being a kid to being an adult, and you didn't have certainty that your storehouses would hold enough grain for a bad harvest year or a bad winter, and you had some tribe next door that wanted to go to war, and so you got an adult body, you got to become an adult. You got to fight for us. You got to work full time. You got to leave school. You have to pretend you're morally fully formed. For those of us who have teenagers at home, who thinks your 18-year-old son has a frontal lobe that's fully done bacon yet? And he's ready to make every decision on his own with enough self-restraint and self-discipline and self-control. And you acted like you went from childhood to adulthood and the switch flipped. And you're now an adult, and you get married, you procreate, you form an independent household, you school leave, you work full time, etc. Adolescence was this new idea that perhaps for 18 months to 4 years, we would create a greenhouse phase, and we'd say, hey, maybe not every marker of going from childhood to adulthood happens at the same time just because you hit puberty. And so we created this protective space. You went to school a little bit longer. You didn't have to work full time yet. You didn't necessarily form a new household and start procreating. Lots of great things happened because we created a little bit of a, I'm usually a skeptic of safe spaces, but it's kind of nice for 13-year-olds to have a little bit of safe space and not be pushed entirely out of the nest. What we're doing now, as the richest people at any time and place in human history, is we've stopped to think about adolescence as a means to an end. And we've started to think about it as an end in itself, like maybe the destiny is to be forever young as a 15-year-old. That's a terrible idea, not just for our kids, but for civilization. And so Peter Pan, Disney has tried to remake it as a utopia, like you just get to stay in Neverland. If you go back and read the original Peter Pan, it's a dystopian hell. Like, this guy is a murderer. He's got an adult body, and he's out there killing people, but he has no moral sense and no historical memory, and he doesn't remember what he did yesterday. Right now, it's increasingly difficult to tell our 10 and our 15 and our 20 and 25-year-olds apart. And if you drop somebody in from a time machine in human history past, they wouldn't be able to make any sense of that. That 18 to 24-year-old males, pushing half of our college-aged males, spend half of their waking hours playing video games. Like, I'm not meaning to sort of beat somebody up for 1 month poorly spent with a Tetris addiction in 1991. We've been there. But the idea that you would sort of think it's normal to think of consumption categories instead of production categories as the way you spend your teen years, as opposed to this being a means to an end. And so I think we want to see a lot more pluralization of higher ed. And then we want to see the demands of that, like helping our kids achieve bigger and better and long-term, durable character that's going to be able to navigate 40 and 45 and 50-year-old disruptions. If we think about how to spend the time of 18 to 22-year-olds, it should make us rethink 18 and 17 and 16 a little bit. So I'd like to see a mass pluralization, maybe mass is the wrong word, broad diversification of higher ed institutions, and then I'd like to see that crowd down into secondary ed to pluralize that a bit more as well. I'm sorry that I have to vote, but we need good judges on the court. Not super legislators, we need judges. So I got to flee.
Would you join me in thanking Senator Sasse? Thanks. Thankfully, Alex has the decency to stay for the full time. We do have the secretary for 5 more minutes. Great discussion. I think we ought to invite the secretary and the senator back together, Jimmy, hopefully here. You could see the two of you really having a role to play in helping us think deeply about these issues. Mr. Secretary, let me ask the same question to you. As you think about experimentation and innovation, you noted this just a moment ago in education, what might that look like pushing down into high school?
First, let me once again agree with the importance to have a pluralization in the education system. But as we think about that, I think it's important to think how we talk about education and approach it. And so I talked about the emphasis on output as opposed to input. And let me be clear, the research mission of universities is important and is critical and has given us our competitive advantage as a nation. But that should not come to the exclusion of the education mission of universities, right? And so you can have some that focus on A, some that focus on B, some that focus on both research and education. And you can have a fair amount of diversity. I think it's also important to talk about what we mean by education. So I relayed the story of one state and the statistics around one state. Let me relay an experience I had in another state. I was speaking with the vice chancellor of that state school system. And I was talking about how we're not teaching practical skills, that we're just focused on theory, and how we're not preparing a vast number of students for the working world. And he said, Mr. Secretary, you're absolutely right. We have been focusing far too much on the AP and the IB courses. And so we are telling our high schools in preparation for college to focus much more on SAT prep and ACT prep. And I kind of looked at him and I'm like, I think you just proved my point, right? The vast majority of jobs are not determined by these prep courses, right? Yet one of the other issues out there is as we talk about education, we tend to talk about education in a very narrow way. We tend to talk about preparation for selective colleges, not preparation for life. And if those are the metrics that we judge our high schools by, then it's no surprise that our high schools focus on selective students and that our high schools focus only on those courses that prepare, not only, but more heavily on those courses that prepare those selective students for selective admissions to selective colleges. And in the process, you're ignoring a whole lot of folks that need preparation for life. And so if you look and you do surveys, early on, kids love to learn. And then we start losing them, and we start losing them, and we start losing them. And you start seeing dropout rates. And how much of that is on the student versus on us for emphasizing the wrong things, for not working to connect what students are learning with life skills? So I was in Pennsylvania recently, and I was at a training facility, an education facility for carpenters. And they had a math book. and it was math for carpentry. And they're learning real math, and it works, but it connects math to a life skill. Mm-hmm. You know, are we thinking about teaching math in the context of life skills that lead to jobs, or are we thinking of teaching math in the context of theory for an SAT test? And I think that's one of the challenges that we have now with our education system. What is the purpose of education? To prepare someone for life or to prepare someone for a high-stakes test that leads to admission to a selective college? And if it's the latter, you just ignored a large, I would argue, more than a majority of our population.
Before we go to you for any closing comments, Mr. Secretary, a quick case study. A criminal justice major and police academy. Say more.
So this is a story I like to tell. I knew a young man who wanted to be a police officer. And he was advised to go to college and major in criminal justice, which is great. And so he took several years. He took out loans. He graduated in criminal justice. And then he went on to be a security guard. Because at no point was he given the practical skills of policing. So here's a question. How many in the audience ever participated in a study abroad? Okay, so I'd say about half, almost half. You know, colleges give credit for study abroad. If you can give credit for a study abroad, and you can give credit for what they have now is a study at sea where you spend a semester on a cruise ship going to different ports and seeing parts of the nation, why can't you give credit for a semester at the police academy? Right? You learn rigorous skills at a police academy. You learn the rules of policing. You learn how to be a police officer, which is a life skill. You learn discipline. I would argue you learn, you know, at least as much as you do a study abroad. And wouldn't it be interesting to see higher education embracing sort of life education by recognizing that one can get credit for things like spending a semester at police academy? Because what you then have is a young man who wants to be a police officer becoming a lifelong learner by getting an education, but also becoming a lifelong earner by becoming a police officer. And that, to me, is what education's about.
Last question, Mr. Secretary. Are you more optimistic or pessimistic as you think about this world of AI, machine learning, automation?
So I figured I'd get the question and came prepared. Yesterday, Bureau of Labor Statistics released a study. 11.5 million jobs estimated in the next 10 years. So I have a list here of job growth. And you've got one industry sector, 754,000 jobs. The next industry sector, 580,000 jobs. Registered nurses, 437,000 new jobs. Home health aides, 425,000. Software developers, 253,000. I can go on and on. Medical assistants, 184,000. Waiters and waitresses, 182,000. Nursing assistants, 164,000. Construction, 153,000. Mm-hmm. So, one, we're creating jobs, and that's great. Two, we have job openings in the economy right now. We have 6.1 million open jobs. Our issue is not job creation. We're creating jobs at a record pace, 1.1 million new jobs simply since January. Our issue is how do we fill those open jobs? Are our educational institutions providing the skills that the workplace is demanding? And so I guess I'll close with this. Early on, when I became secretary, I went to the G20 Conference of Labor Ministers. The number one issue among the G20 labor ministers was the skills gap. Every nation there spent the majority of their time talking about the gap between the skills being taught by higher education or by high schools and the skills demanded of the workplace. So I would say the challenge, and this is why I'm optimistic, the hard part is job creation, but that is happening. The easier part should be working with educational institutions so that they actually teach the skills that are demanded, so that the focus is on how do we help the student become not just a lifelong learner, but a lifelong earner. And so if we get that right, we're going to be an amazing, amazing nation with a great future.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Please join me in thanking Alex.
Thank you.
Jimmy.
So, Secretary, it's really a privilege to have you. We're grateful for what you've done in the private sector and now in the administration. One of the things that we want to always remind people is that public service is a high calling. Politicians get, and anybody who goes into civil service, it gets a bum rap. You look at the approval ratings in society, but we need people who care, who are practicing citizenship at its highest level, mm-hmm. and to have you come in and serve the nation, you know, I think all of us owe you a debt of gratitude, and we certainly esteem and appreciate your commitment to this country and to the world and to freedom. So
it's a privilege. Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
So we want to get a quick picture. Lee, we're going to do a quick picture. Then I'm going to quickly meet with you. And then, so Tim, are you around? And then we'll keep moving. You get in the middle. We need it.
Oh. I never get to be the rose between all these thorns. Here, I'll let the secretary get in the middle.
There we go.
Good angle for Jimmy.
Get the right side of my face. It's hard. Thanks. Great. Thanks, Dan. Dan, thank you. Great to meet you. Dan Bryant has been a longtime friend and does a fantastic job. He served in the government during the W administration. One of the things that sticks out the most to me, the thing that means the most to the Kemp Foundation, and this comes not from my father, but from my mom, is the power of the personal. And what you heard in that discussion was we've got this phenomenal potential in the world to improve the way that goods get delivered, that services are provided, that people can get connected, that messages can get out. But ultimately, in a civil society, in a thriving, flourishing society, we've got to have real connection and humans who are able to engage with one another. And it's a discussion that we need to have. It doesn't mean that we cower in fear at the incredible technological innovations that that make being a parent, as my wife and I are, of an 18, 16, 14, and 11-year-old boys. And how do we handle these computers that are in the hands everywhere they go? How do we monitor them? And it's easy to become overwhelmed with fear and concern. But how do we really engage with them in a way to help them figure out how to deal with the challenges that are presented with having access to anything at any time on the negative side? But how do you take advantage of that and think about it through the lens of our values? And so at the Kemp Foundation, our emphasis is always on the American idea, the Judeo-Christian values that are embodied in the Declaration of Independence, and to have leaders like Dan, Senator Sasse, Secretary Acosta, both all of whom have been in and out of government, it's critical to have them willing to have those conversations and think about policy through the lens of the power of the personal, which is what my mom taught me. So we've gone from kind of the big overview of what's possible, the great potential that we're on the brink of with the coming productivity boom, to a discussion about the future of work, what's possible, what some of the challenges are, and how we can engage certainly on the education front to prepare our workforce for the future. And now we're going to talk about some of the practical policy approaches to this new digital economy. And policy gets down in the weeds, and there are lots of differing perspectives, but we want to have a civil competition of ideas and we're really pleased that we've got a great moderator who I'd like to introduce now, Mark Jamison from AEI. He came up from Florida, and Mark has had a great and long career. You can read about in his bio. His bio, as opposed to our other AEI fellow, Bret Swanson, Mark's bio is correct. But there's something really important about Mark that you all need to know. He is going to get married in 2.5 weeks. And when you think about what life means and what the fullness means, it is connecting. And marriage is at the core of who we are as humans. All of us come from the union of two people. That's how it happens. It's always fun to talk to my boys as they are growing up about the realities of procreation. But marriage is an incredible gift. It's taught me so much about myself and life, and so certainly we want to celebrate the marriage of Mark and Marilyn, right? Best wishes to you, Marilyn. And Mark Jamison, would you please come up and introduce the panel that we're having? Please welcome Mark Jamison.
Thank you, Jimmy. Appreciate it. Let me grab my paper here.
Oh, yeah, you're allowed.
Thanks.
Well, first, I'd like to thank Jimmy, the other people working in the Kemp Foundation, for the opportunity to chair this panel. As they indicated, we're at a remarkable point in our country where we can accomplish a lot of things if we can get our policies right, our people right, and get the skills in the right places at the right time. And excited to be able to have that conversation. We have an excellent panel to be talking about that with us this morning. We have Congressman Hurd. He's representative for the 23rd District in Texas. If you are familiar with that district or look at the map, you'll see it bridges all the way from San Antonio to El Paso. And if you think about the populations there, what the economy is doing, it is on the cutting edge, is on the edge of what is going on in this country. All the opportunities, all the challenges are exactly right there. He graduated from Texas A&M. He worked for the CIA in the Middle East, and so he knows what it means to be in a difficult place, not just Congress, but also a CIA in the Middle East. He's now on the House Permanent Select Intelligence Committee, so grateful to have him with us. We also have Chris Liddell with us as well. He's assistant to the president and director for the Strategic Initiatives in the White House Office of Innovation. He graduated from Oxford University. And if you look at his bio, he's been the CFO of General Motors, Microsoft, International Paper, executives in other businesses as well, so someone who understands what it takes for a business to be effective, to be innovative, to create value. He's the person who knows how to practice leadership in that environment, so we're really glad to have him as well. Then also we have Commissioner McSweeny with the Federal Trade Commission. She has served as the chief counsel for competition policy and intergovernmental relations with the Department of Justice. She was a deputy assistant to President Obama and a policy advisor to Vice President Biden as well. So we're really glad to have them. And I'm going to move up here and we'll get our conversation started. So our conversation so far has all been about innovation. It's all been about creating the future. And one of the things that I think strikes people sometimes is not only is innovation critical in the private sector, which we'll get to in our discussions, but it's critical in government. And sometimes government's the most challenged entity for that innovation, for getting the information technologies in the right places at the right time. And I just want to open that for the panel and tell us about how you think about what can we do in government to get government innovating in the right way. And I'd start with the congressman. Do you mind?
Sure. I think we have to start with what is actually the problem, and I'll get into the weeds a little bit. The technical challenges that we face are all solvable, but it starts with having the right leadership in all these places. I spoke at an event yesterday, and the topic of the event was whether or not the federal government should move into the cloud.
hello, like the cloud is not emerging technology, it's emerged. And we should be talking about how are we using artificial intelligence, how are we using machine learning on the data that we're doing. But we gotta make sure the folks that make these decisions have the power and the tool to do that. And I'm speaking specifically on CIOs. And we also need to have people within these agencies that are focused on, and something I'm still Chris's line, citizen-facing services from these agencies. And you shouldn't have to get your passport, you shouldn't have to go to a post office to get your passport renewed, right? Not, can't you do it from the comfort of your own home? But we need to have people that feel empowered, and we need to have people that have the right skill sets to do this. We should be talking about blockchain, and how are we using blockchain in customs? How are we using blockchain in food safety? Instead of talking about technology that's 10, 15, 20 years old. And I think the role Congress should have is shining a light on all of these practices within those agencies. But it takes leadership. You know, I'm a big fan of Tony Scott, the former federal CIO. He was doing, now we have Chris Liddell that really, and his office, that is making sure it starts from the top. Cybersecurity innovation is a responsibility of the C-suite, and those agency heads need to understand that. And if they don't, then Congress should be providing that oversight and making sure they're doing it.
Commissioner, eventually I'll go to you, and I'll ask you to think about that within respect to your own agency. But let me start with the White House and how it's thinking about providing that kind of leadership. What are your thoughts, Chris?
Yeah, so just to build on the Congressman's comments, firstly, start with the opportunity. I've never actually seen as much opportunity for innovation as I see in the government and in the time that I've been here, which is relatively short. But one of the first things I did in the first month is go and meet with every CIO and talk to them about it, and talk to the other people like the ex-CIO, federal CIO. And there's a high degree of commonality on the what. What's missing is the how. And to build on the comments, firstly, leadership at the White House. We've created that with Jared Kushner, Office of American Innovation, myself, focusing through American Technology Council. So we've created a focus. But it's about the organizing ourselves, focusing on the right things. We spend a huge amount of money on IT. Again, it's not a monetary issue. We spend $85 billion, and that probably understates it. So we spend vastly more per head than the private sector does, but we don't necessarily spend it in the right ways. So this is an issue of implementation. It's an issue of how, not what. There is a vast amount of innovation in citizen-facing services, in cybersecurity, in cloud-based services. There's innovation opportunities everywhere. What we need to do is be better organized to actually do it, and that's the focus that we're bringing from the White House.
Okay, great. And Commissioner, you've seen successes and failures, your time in the White House, now your time in an agency. What are your thoughts?
Well, I'd like to start by just saying thanks for having me. Obviously, I'm bringing a bipartisan flavor to this conversation, and I really appreciate both the willingness to have a bipartisan conversation on this topic. And I also think it underscores the fact that this is not a Democrat or Republican issue, that these are areas where we have a lot of consensus, and that's right. So I would say, building on what the Congressman just said, the important thing is that we are innovating in a sensible way. There's a huge amount of potential, but very often what we're missing in the government is the technical expertise. So one of the innovations that I am proudest of at the FTC, for example, is our creation of an Office of Technology Research and Investigation, our active onboarding of technologists and computer scientists into the work that we're doing, which is really beneficial not just in making sure we're making sensible decisions with our own IT needs, but that we're making policy decisions and law enforcement decisions that are informed by technical expertise about the technology we're talking about. Because too often, the policy conversation or even the procurement conversation isn't as informed as it needs to be. And I think that's an area where we have a huge amount of consensus, and it's incredibly important to policymakers. So I like to see the continued support for that, and I think it's really, really important. There's also a huge amount of data, for example, that the government has. And one of the things that I think was very successful that I think we are continuing in the Trump administration is thinking about ways in which government data can be useful and ways in which we should both protect the privacy of the people whose data it is, but make it available in a privacy-protective way so that we can spur innovation. This is incredibly important, for example, if we're thinking about how to train the next machine learning and artificial intelligence technologies. There are huge data advantages out there in the marketplace, but we can make some of the government data available to help new entrants, but also some of the top innovators in the space.
No, I can just build on that, because I totally agree with it. What we've seen in citizen-facing services, if we focus on that aspect rather than the infrastructure that sits below it, we've made some progress in the government, but the shape of the curve, if you like, is less than in the private sector. So the private sector has been innovating faster than the public sector. So we've been making progress, but we're falling further behind. Part of the solution is obviously to get more agile in the way that we develop citizen-facing services. Part of it is engaging the private sector in a way to get the best of every mind in the country focused on it. So we have this disconnect where the leader in just about every form of technology in the country except government technology. So to your point, how do we open up data so that we not only have to build the things that we're building faster, but we encourage the private sector to access data and innovate in a way that will change the shape of the curve so that we're innovating at least as fast as the private sector.
But one thing that they both have touched on, it's something I spend a lot of time on, and I've never, when I first ran for office, I never mentioned these words, IT procurement, right? It is not a sexy topic. But when the people that are purchasing the IT goods and services are different than the people using the IT goods and services, you're going to have a disconnect. And I think if we look at where is innovation happening in the government quickly, I would always look to the intelligence services, small, nimble, special forces in the military, small, nimble. The people that need something are also the ones involved in the development of it. And so you see that the end user is pushing that. And that's not always the environment that we have in other parts of the federal government. And we have challenges in the way. I always talk about a cyber proving ground in San Antonio. The 24th Air Force, Congress gave the commander of the 24th Air Force up to $10 million to buy a digital tool that they need to defend their infrastructure. But the idea was, hey, we have a problem. Tomorrow at 2 p.m., everybody come in the room. We're going to draw it on the whiteboard. Whoever has a 15-day solution, a 30-day solution, 60-day solution, I have the money to buy it. Right? It's like, hey, that's a great idea, except you have to have security clearance in order to hear that problem. And if you don't have an existing contract, you can't get a security clearance. And so the people that could ultimately probably have something on the shelf that can solve a problem, we can't get it in to the government. And so these are some of the barriers that we have to get through when you have the right leadership.
Yeah. Well, one of the things that happens with information technologies and making them customer-facing is that you have an opportunity to build trust and connection with the constituents that you have, but they, as the commissioner indicated, they also have to trust your keeping their information private, secure, not misusing it. How do you build that with our constituents?
Well, I'll take a shot at that. How about that?
Sure.
I think that we have really good frameworks that we can use to make sure that we are balancing privacy with also opening data. And we've articulated a lot of them. I don't think it's particularly controversial. And we also have the advantage of the research that's ongoing on the cutting edge of technologies like homomorphic encryption, where we can also access large amounts of information, compare and make inference from them, but keep the information fundamentally private as well. DARPA is doing terrific research on this. I think the government investing in research in this area continues to be incredibly important, not just in privacy protective technology development, but technology development in general and how we can continue to open some of our data, but continue to be a cutting edge investor in some of the newest technology and the newest capabilities around. So I would combine both of those things, and of course mention workforce and training is incredibly important as well. We have a tremendous natural resource in this country, in our civil society, in our research community. I work a lot directly with hackers. I think they're a tremendous resource, especially when they are White Hat Hackers. We had the pleasure of actually being at DEF CON together this year, the congressman and I, slightly different times, but I think both really experiencing and blown away by the capabilities that we actually have out there in our labor workforce, and making sure that we are mindful of those capabilities and harnessing those capabilities and coming up with creative ways to learn from them, I think is really, really important.
And part of the solution in my mind is bringing the best of government and the best of the private sector together to solve the problem. So we had a conference a couple of months ago where we brought in 20 of the biggest companies in the country. From a technology point of view, we split them into 10 streams. One of the streams was cybersecurity. So how do we bring the best practices from the private sector into the government? As a result of that, we wrote a report, 100-page report, on how we actually modernize the government around cybersecurity and protecting people's information. And we opened that report up to public scrutiny. So we asked people to comment on it. So part of it is being transparent about what we are doing and making sure we have the best thinking coming in. And we had 100 companies actually comment on that report. And we're now digesting their information, putting it into the final report, and then implementing it. So if we can bring the best thinking from the private sector and have a open, transparent process where we bring that in and then have a formal structure where we actually implement the best recommendations, we've got the best chance of getting trust.
Trust is such an important word, especially now when there's a lack of trust in civil institutions. And I was in Estonia recently, and Estonia, every government service you can do online. And now, Estonia is only 1.3 million people in the entire country, which is basically the size of San Antonio. But it is, and they were able to do it because they have established trust with the people. And this is after some major attacks by the Russian government. So having that trust, and the way we do that within the federal government, you got to protect people's data. And the only way we're going to get there is following basic digital hygiene. And we're not. Most of the hacks that have happened, OPM, Equifax, these are not zero-day exploits, zero-day being a previously unknown vulnerability. These are basic things that we knew, and if we would have patched, we would have protected it. Yeah. And so making sure that when it comes to securing our digital infrastructure, you're doing the basics. If you do the basics well, you're going to protect yourself from 85-90%. And that's how you reestablish the trust with the American people. And then you start having this liberal access to data and seeing what's going on and making sure there's transparency. That's how we reestablish that trust, and it allows us to start doing some interesting things.
You also need a system which is continuously responding to new challenges. So today's problem is not going to be tomorrow's problem. It'll be a new and different one. So you need to not only fix today's problem, you need a system which basically innovates continuously, and that's why you need to get the private sector and the public sector working together on best practices.
Okay. Well, we've brought into the discussion the private sector and its role within the space we've been talking about. There are a lot of controversial and difficult issues with respect to the technology firms, and do people trust them, do they not? Part of the discussion has been they have grown in tremendous sizes. The largest country in the world is now Facebook, 2 billion citizens of Facebook, if you will. Larger than China, if you add China, the US, and Mexico together, we're about the size of Facebook. So some people are concerned. What does Facebook know about me? How much power does it have? People have been concerned with things about Amazon and Google as well, with their magnitude, their size of things that they're doing. What are your thoughts? Is there a government response to this, or is it this is the natural pace of an industry that is evolving rapidly and taking advantage of its new economics? What are your thoughts in that space?
Well, look, we can't be afraid of technology, right? You know, we got to be ready to evolve, but we also have to understand what you're doing with it, right? You need to understand what information these tools have of yours. And, you know, a lot of these debates degenerate down into privacy versus security, right? I think you can do both. You can defend digital infrastructure, chase bad guys, and protect our civil liberties all at the same time. Our civil liberties are not burdens. They are the things that make our country great. And we should always be protecting them. And this debate is going to constantly happen whenever there's new technology. When quantum computing becomes a reality, we're going to have this, we're going to have this debate again. But as users, we have to be aware of what tools are out there. And we have to know what information is there. Look, in schools, we oftentimes teach how an engine works, right, in a car. But are we teaching kids how the internet actually works? Right? Are we teaching kids how, you know, how social, the fundamentals of why social media and why a company like Facebook has ultimately got to 2 billion users? We don't. And they need to have a better understanding of these things that are so ubiquitous in their lives. And I think when you have a better understanding of the tools and how they work, you also understand the challenges that are there.
Okay. Commissioner McSweeny, is that too close to your space of your actual work?
Well, our focus is really internal. And so, you know, the government should have its own standards on behavior and how it uses information. And we should set those. But to what the Congress says, we should have best practices from the private sector, but the way in which the policies and how we use information should be specific to the government.
I think I'll agree with what the Congressman said in terms of I think it's important to be really specific about the kinds of harms that we're concerned about and to be mindful of the fact that we do have really good frameworks in place if we use them to provide appropriate checks and balances. So yes, I think that we can have privacy and security as long as we have appropriate oversight and get the balance right on that. But I do think that we are at an interesting inflection point. The technology companies that we're talking about, particularly the very large ones, are having a powerful impact on our lives and on markets and even on democratic institutions. So I think it's incredibly important for us to be mindful of the fact that I don't think we want to get rid of the notion of having major industries that are shaping all of our lives be accountable to democratic institutions. I think the Congressman is doing some really interesting work on this front when we think about the interference in our election process and the consequences of that for all of us. I think all of us should care very deeply about that. I deeply hope that we could have more bipartisan work together on privacy and data security legislation, because I think we're probably not in a very different place in terms of wanting to make sure that consumers actually have access to information, have maybe some rights to their data, have some ways to interact with the consequences of the technology in their lives that are a little bit more meaningful than the choices we're currently being offered. I would love to be able to teach my kids about what being connected to the internet means. I have kids, I'm raising them as digital natives, it's a challenge. I can't even tell them what it means because I can't tell them for sure unless I simply keep them off of a platform where their data goes any more than I can tell my mom where her data is going. And I think we are approaching a moment where there are certain situations where consumers are no longer comfortable with the trust us response on that. And we have to be mindful of that because consumer trust is a really important aspect of demand for new technology. And the last thing we want to do is create so much concern and fear out there that we aren't really getting the benefit of all of the technologies that are flowing into our lives. I don't think we should be anti-tech at all. I think we should be pro-innovation. We need to make sure that we're hearing and understanding, responding to some of the consequences of this innovation in our lives.
There are we're focused on some of the social media firms right now. And a lot of that is because of the ads in our elections that the Russians purchased. But Equifax, nobody in this room opted in to give our information to Equifax. Nobody in this room opted in to any of the other credit monitoring or companies. And that is a integral part to authentication, right? Identifying someone is indeed who we think they are. And that has been, that foundation has been broken. And so there wasn't a violation of the law, but you know, nobody's been able to explain how did Equifax get all that information? You know, they you know, there was no breach standards that were broken. And so, I think this is going to be a case that I hope people have been poring over of how we got there and how we prevent that from ultimately happening. And we have to separate protecting information from disinformation, right? Or covert influence is how I would say that in my old job at the CIA. And how do you counter misinformation, disinformation, right? The Russians have been doing this for decades in Europe. They're gonna continue to do that. We don't have a strategy on how to deal with disinformation. And so that is a broader question. When the ability to touch an individual, it's so fast, you can touch anywhere, you know, around the world, but we've dealt with this in other mediums, and we just have to adjust those tactics, techniques, and procedures into this new environment.
If I may, I mean, the way I like to think about this, and I come from obviously a law enforcement agency that oversees a lot of the technology we're talking about from a consumer perspective, is that I don't think it's going to continue to be acceptable for congressman to ask a company why something happened and for the answer to come back, well, we don't really know, the technology just did that. And that's currently the answer we get some of the time. I think we were okay with that maybe for a while when we were talking about shoe advertisements following people around the internet, but we need to be mindful of the fact that the technology we're now talking about is predictive, it's powerful, and it's increasingly autonomous. And I think we as humans actually want to be in that conversation about how what technology is doing, what decisions it's making for us, and whether we're okay with those decisions, or at the very least, how did it make those set of decisions? I mean, we're having a really active conversation about this right now in the use of predictive technology that's moderately intelligent in sentencing and criminal justice system. I'm deeply concerned about whether we have appropriate oversight by humans of that kind of technology, and I think it's a topic that we should all be talking about.
Let me take us just a little bit further into that space of innovation. And talk about the entrepreneurs in the country. I'm struck, 90% of my work is trotting around the world working with people, but I also work with a lot of 20-year-olds and 30-year-olds and 40-year-olds here in the U.S. I had a wonderful conversation, I think it was just yesterday, with one of my former students who's now in Silicon Valley, one of my current students, and they were trying to figure out what they could do in the cryptocurrency space together. That sense of entrepreneurship of the younger generation is just incredible, the things that they can do. What are the right government policies that should be in place to really let that entrepreneurship flourish, create the next economy for us?
I think the Office of American Innovation should start with that question.
Well, our focus is internal, so the federal system, and clearly there is a huge opportunity in terms of people building services on top of the government. So from an entrepreneurship, GovTech, I think, is one of the biggest opportunities we have. It's one of the least developed areas. So some of the other areas that people are focused on, like social networks, there are plenty of people in that space. There's not that many entrepreneurs building services for the government, for the 320 million customers that we have. So in terms of the policies we need to do, we talked about continuing with an open data approach. The other point that we make, making it easier for people to actually contract with the government. One of the biggest pain points for small businesses is it's really difficult to contract with the government. It's expensive, it's difficult, and it's time consuming. So our contracting system unfortunately favors the larger companies in this thing. So we need to make it easier for small businesses to work with the government, contract with the government, and build services for citizens using the government system.
And stay out of the way, right? You know, like that's, let's not overly regulate something, let's not get too far in the way. The example I use is everybody kind of knows what Ethernet is, right? The little Ethernet jack. But there used to be a thing called Token Ring, which did the same, and there were a lot of computers that had to have a Token Ring and Ethernet jack in it. It wasn't the government that decided that Ethernet was going to be the technology that everyone was going to use, right? It was markets that allowed that to happen. And I think sometimes being afraid of technology, you know, when some researchers were able to hack a car a couple of years ago, everybody wanted to react and knee-jerk reaction, like, oh my God, well, it's still pretty hard to hack a car barreling down the highway at 90 miles an hour. Can it be done? If you have complete access to something, yes. Are these things that we should be mindful of as our car becomes a very large connected device? Yes, but we shouldn't be overly burdensome and let innovation grow. And then we also got to make sure that we've all said it, you know, education. And we look, a lot of states mandate that every school is supposed to have a computer science class. Only like 4% of high schools across the United States of America have a computer science class. And look, I took music when I was in school. I took history. I took a lot of math. I am neither a musician, mathematician, or you know, political scientist, right? But having exposure to these things, especially at a young age, and I'm working on trying to get this into middle schools and making sure 7th and 8th graders are exposed to coding, I think the sooner we get people exposed to it, the more that ember can potentially grow, and it not only make them a digital native with the tools, but also the programming and the details that go behind it.
I guess I would add, probably not surprisingly, that I think an open competitive marketplace is incredibly important. And one of the things that we're seeing increasingly that potentially threatens entrants and entrepreneurs is whether we really are adequately protecting an open marketplace. Strong antitrust competition enforcement is deeply important. I actually happen to believe that clear regulations to protect the open internet is a really important aspect of entrepreneurial activity in that space, especially. I would also add that government investment in research and development, especially in technology, is absolutely vital. We've seen over and over and over again the tremendous innovation benefit that flows from the U.S. investing in a little thing called the World Wide Web. And I think that we need to be mindful of the fact that we have an excellent track record of trying to protect that space for innovation and invest in it and grow the new technologies. And so I would continue to encourage those policies as well.
Okay. Jimmy, our time is up. Could we take a question from the audience? I've monopolized things, or do you want to move on?
Take a question.
One question. Your hand was already up.
I have a question about stifling of innovation. In my experience, technology for archiving data that's non-magnetic will last a couple hundred years. CIA awarded me a contract to prove it worked. We proved it worked. The Library of Congress loves it. NARA loves it. All the Hollywood studios love it. I've spoken to everybody from Amazon to Western Digital and all the alphabet in between. And they view it as disruptive because they view it'll ruin their current business model, people having to keep migrating data endlessly, even in cloud storage and stuff like that. I'd love to have any advice on innovation there because we've proven it works, and it's incredibly inexpensive. That's why they view it as disruptive. But it's literally, it survives benign neglect. You can store it from 15 to 150 degrees Fahrenheit. Any suggestions for innovation?
So that sounded more like a statement than an advertisement than a question. but why don't you eat? I'm not. What's your question, sorry?
So if I can't seem to get the existing stakeholders to want to step behind it because they view it, it's going to hurt their current business because so they don't want to encourage it to be a success.
Again, it sounded like an advertisement for whatever you're doing. But I'm happy to take whatever their issue is, and if there's a specific blocking, then address it.
Private and or public and or people in the mix
how can we actually support said innovation so that we can actually push our economies forward?
I'll take that. Chris said it earlier. We have to, the way procurement laws are done are old and old-fashioned. And we should be able to make it easy for the proverbial two gals in a garage to be able to introduce technology into Fortune Zero, right, which is the government, largest entity in the world. And the way we do that is, as I said earlier, folks that are going to ultimately use that service being the ones involved in the purchasing decisions, streamlining the process so that you don't have to have 10 lawyers in order to develop the RFP. We got to stop having, when an RFP is submitted, that is actually the time you should be engaging with vendors to make sure their response to it actually meets the goals. So these are some of the things that we have to change writ large across the government. And if you, Liz, or you, Robert, have specifics of things that you've experienced in government procurement, let me know and say, hey, this is the barrier that I had. Because if you've had it, other people have.
Yeah, would love to hear those examples.
All right, so join me in thanking the panel for the work they did. Appreciate it very much.
Thank you.
Good job.
Can you come this way, and we'll get a quick picture? Yeah, we need you in the middle. Thank you. Thank you all once again. Thanks. Good to see you. Thanks so much. Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it. So next, we want stories are important. People's passions and the questions that were asked. How can people bust in and bust through? Well, we're pleased to have some vignettes that we're going to have folks share. And right now we've got a company called Two Marines Moving. Everybody's got to move in life. We've talked about the marketplace for jobs, being willing to adapt. So there's no doubt that there's always going to be a market for people getting all their stuff from one place to another. And we're thrilled to have Marines who started a company come up and tell their story. So please welcome Christy Cater and Nick Balcom. Nick is the president and founder, and Christy is the vice president and co-founder. So Nick and Christy, come up. Thank you.
Thank you.
And how are you?
Hi.
Christy, how are you? Let's see if I can, oh, look at that. I don't know how you can control this from there. The on-off button doesn't matter whether or not it's on. So Nick and Christy, share your story with us, and obviously there's no doubt that the internet's existence helped you. So tell us about where you came from, how you started the company, and where things are today.
Excellent. Well, thank you. Thank you for having us here. And I think we have a very interesting story, and I think an inspirational one as well. I come from a background of military service in my family. My grandfather was at Pearl Harbor when it was attacked on December 7th. His dad was in World War I. His grandfather was in the Civil War and then going back to the American Revolution. And I just learned that actually last year when I went back to Iowa for a family get-together. And so I didn't even realize, no one said, hey, you should join the military, or you should serve. It just kind of is a thing in my family, I guess. And I was in high school at when 9/11 happened, a senior in high school. And that's when I decided that I was going to join the Marines. And then I joined the Marine Corps and got so much out of it. I did 6 years in the Marines. I was an infantry squad leader, a sergeant. Like, it's kind of, even being a CO, it's kind of hard to compare, like, being with your battle buddies at 0-3 in the morning, coming out of a helicopter. Like, you can't do that, you know, and anywhere else. And so then I got out in 2008, and that's also when I met Christy, and then we moved to Washington, D.C. together, and she had a job at Robert Half, and I did not have a job, and I was fresh out of the Marine Corps, and I'd been a serial entrepreneur before. It's always been an interest, and I got another phone call or a text message from a friend like, hey, can you come help me move? And
you're a Marine, help me move.
I'm a Marine, help me move. They're like, you got some muscles, let's go.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's always friends and here's some beer and pizza. And I'm like, you know what, I'm not going to do this for beer and pizza anymore. and then Christy was on November 10th, the Marine Corps birthday. And then we started the company and Christy was right there with me the whole way. And it took off. We did $600,000 in revenue our first year.
Where'd you get your money from to start?
My credit cards.
Your credit cards.
We had no bank was going to give us a loan. It was 2008, 2009. We were in a recession. We just wrote on the debt of my credit cards. We started the business out of our apartment. It was a very small one-bedroom apartment. I was pregnant at the time with our son. We had a lot of really important things happening at the same time.
So you were invested in more ways than just your...
Yes, it was all, you know, we talk about the American dream, and there are definitely barriers to entry in the market, but our story is the American dream. We did not have anyone giving us money. We come from, I guess, lower middle class families. You know, my dad was a union factory worker. You know,
my dad worked at FedEx.
We didn't have, you know, donors or angel investors, anything like that. We had some great mentors, and we had desks in our apartment and iPhones and Google Calendars. Yep. Literally, it was our first software that we used to book our moves. Google mm-hmm. Calendars was our software.
Yeah.
And so. in the body of the message, we put in the customer's name, phone number, email,
yep.
and because we didn't have money for moving software like we use now.
Right.
So but that it, was
it,
free.
It was there.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Who were your mentors?
One of our mentors that we met early on, Oscar Weigel, his family owns a group of automotive repair shops in the area. And he actually met Nick because Nick had a Tennessee plate still. You know, when you get out of the military, you keep your plates as long as you can until you're forced to go to the DMV and register where you actually live.
Because you have to move all the time.
So they struck up a conversation, and he rented us a tiny little room in his auto shop. That was our first... technical business address.
With very nice wood panel walls.
I refused. When I saw it, I was pregnant. I'm like, I don't want to be around petroleum products. I'm not going to work here. And within a day of thinking I was going to, you know, work from home and you know, do all the things that I needed to do, I realized I had no choice but to show up at this place every day. So we became very acquainted with the auto business. Maybe that'll be our next
It worked
thing.
Out great because he rented us U-Hauls. Because he has a U-Haul franchise there. He repaired our trucks when we were finally able to purchase trucks. And then he also owns part of the insurance company that we use. So as a mentor, I don't know, godfather, something like that. Yeah.
That's how big Oscar's are you great. Today?
Now we're about 100 employees.
Yep.
And so we hire from the Marines, Army, Navy, Air Force, and then we have two locations. Our headquarters is here in Alexandria, Virginia. And then we opened a second location maybe about 2 years ago in South Florida for the Miami-Fort Lauderdale market.
Wow. And what are your plans for the future? What do you see coming down the pike?
Realistically, we see our company as investing in veterans. And so our goal is to create opportunities for other veterans to be entrepreneurs in more of a franchise-based situation.
Yeah.
So we hope to have other locations that other veterans that are exiting the military or, you know, reservists that are looking to invest and grow their own business can be involved in our business.
Yeah. Well, we appreciate you coming to tell your story. There are millions of folks like you, but this is the heartbeat of America and innovation. You all saying, hey, here's what we need. What's out there? What can we use? You found, you know, Google Calendar. It helped you keep everything organized. We got to figure out a way to get capital, not just credit card debt, to folks who have the commitment. That's, you know, the personal story that you all have is one that I think is something that we want to talk about and highlight. And our next speaker, Senator Tim Scott, who's here, and we know that there are Senate votes, so we appreciate you all being here. But he's talking about how to get capital to people who have ideas and a need. And we want to thank you for your work. Bless your family. And thanks for sharing your story. Please
thank you, everyone.
Join me in welcoming.
Thank you.
Thanking them.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nick. Thanks, Christy. Appreciate it. So, as I mentioned earlier, Nelson Mullins is our host for the day. They've given us this this space. And I want to welcome up Chris Cushing, who runs the policy affairs shop here. Chris has been in the policy world for 30 years. I can't tell you how much our foundation, our 501c3 foundation, appreciates having partners who believe in the civil competition of ideas, so that we can have great leaders like Senator Scott come talk to us about how he views opportunity and what he's doing from a legislative perspective to help folks who want to start businesses, who want to take advantage of all the resources that are out there. So Chris, thank you for opening your offices to us please come introduce Senator Scott.
Thank you for being
Thanks,
here.
Thanks, Chris.
I'll first say, because you asked for vignettes, I had the joy of working with your dad to help be part of a team to create the low-income housing tax credit. Yeah. As part of the 86 Tax Act, I have my signed football card from your dad back in my office. The tax credit remains today the most effective affordable housing program in America. It's reported that your father's first break with the Bush administration was to fight for the continuation of that. So it's a living legacy. Welcome to Nelson Mullins, everyone. It's my honor to introduce Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina. The senator has served the citizens of South Carolina at the local, state, and federal levels. In 2010, he was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives, and in 2013, he moved over to the Senate, appointed by then-Governor Nikki Haley. He was elected to the Senate in 2014 and was reelected again last year. I hope he likes campaigning. He also is not shy about hard work. He's a member of five committees: Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs, where he chairs Housing, Transportation, and Urban Development; Finance, where he chairs Fiscal Responsibility and Economic Growth; Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions; Small Business, and Special Aging. Senator Scott comes from a remarkable family. I think I have this correct, sir. His older brother was a command sergeant major in the Army, and his younger brother is a colonel in the Air Force. Senator Scott has said he and his brothers are living his single mother's American dream. The senator's biography states, quote, "An unbridled optimist, he believes, despite our current challenges, that the nation's brightest days are ahead of us." In their 2009 tribute to the life and work of Jack Kemp, the New York Times headline was, "U.S. conservatives lose an optimist." We're glad the optimists are rising in Congress. Our politics and policies are uplifted by leaders with the grace of Jack Kemp and Tim Scott. Our nation is fortunate that the Kemp Foundation and Senator Scott continue to carry forward Jack Kemp's vision of an America with opportunity for all. Ladies and gentlemen, Senator Tim Scott of South Carolina.
Hey, Chris.
Thank you. Good morning to everybody. How are y'all doing today?
Great.
It's a good day, isn't it? Does not Chris have a voice for radio? I was just thinking about my next TV ad or my next radio commercial. I was like, I need his voice working for me. Thank you. Well, I'm not sure you can volunteer because there's probably something illegal about that, so we'll just pay you anyways. Yes, sir. Speaking about jobs, as a matter of fact, I was at Carrabba's on Monday in Charleston. I'm not sure if you guys know where y'all had lunch on Monday, but this was really important lunch. I didn't know it was going to be an important lunch until it became an important lunch. I'm sitting there with a good friend of mine from high school, a guy named Adrian Williams. Adrian was a running back. Your dad was a great quarterback. You were a good quarterback. I was a mediocre running back. Oh, I'm sorry. You were also a great quarterback. And so Adrian and I are sitting there talking about this brand new opportunity he has. His business has been growing. It's the Atlantic South East Engineering Company. And he's saying it's tough to hire the talent he needs because so many folks have to be trained to do the work that he needs to train them. And I started scratching my head and thought to myself, yeah, we can help you with that, Adrian. And Adrian was like, can you tell me how? Can you tell me how you can help me with this? And we started having this conversation about the importance of earning and learning at the same time. and it brought the LEAP Act. Cory Booker and myself have worked hard on creating a tax credit to help employers hire employees who need a little training to become profitable for the company. And there I sat at Carrabba's having a conversation, a real conversation with a real business owner who says it's critically important that he finds a way to subsidize the hiring of new employees because it's so hard to do so. In South Carolina, there are 64,000 jobs that are open today. Across our country, more than 6 million jobs go unfilled, not because you need a college education, because 75% of those jobs do not require a college education. You need someone who's willing to take a chance on that person, someone who has the patience, the perseverance, and the margin in their profit to invest in the next wave of workers. Our tax credit, the LEAP Act, could provide a part of the bridge to the other side so that 6 million more Americans can find themselves employed. And if we were able to do that, I think we'd start seeing the long-term unemployment numbers, nearing 2 million today, fall through the floor. It would be an amazing transformation of the landscape of who we are as a nation if we had the opportunity to reinvest our resources in a way that produces the outcomes that we all know are in our best interest. Now, the same is true when you think about the rebuilding, the reconstruction of neighborhoods and communities. I was thinking over the weekend, thank you, I was reading The Economist magazine, which I'm not here to sell Economist, but I was reading The Economist magazine, and there was an article on how to help places hurt by globalization. And it started talking about the EIG, a nonprofit organization that's done a really good job of solidifying the statistical information necessary to come to the conclusion that sometimes government's best intentions don't go far enough. Sometimes you have to encourage investment by small and large employers, folks who have capital to reinvest in communities. And I said, this sounds a lot like the Investing in Opportunity Act. And then they said there was legislation being championed by folks in Congress. They didn't mention anybody in that article, by the way. But again, I thought it was funny too. Thank you very much for standing and laughing. This is good. So Cory Booker and I have been working on the Investing in Opportunity Act as a way to attract capital back into some of the distressed communities around the country. Our unemployment rate in the African-American community is almost 8%. The poverty rate in this country is around 15%, but in minority communities, it's almost twice as high, 28%. If there was a way for us to attract capital back into some of the communities at risk, and the price for that capital coming back into those communities and taking a long-term chance that they can create value that has a strong ROI, the price of that is simply deferring your capital gains tax for about 7 years so that you have the chance to make a long-term investment. Wouldn't it be worth it? So we have a chance to bring almost $2 trillion of capital into distressed communities, and the official cost is about $1.6 billion. Now, we're going to wrestle through tax reform for the next several weeks. How many of you guys are hoping that we get it done? How many of you guys are just hoping we get something done? Yeah, me too. Both my hands go up. Here's an opportunity for us to not only get something done, but the right thing done for the right people in the right way. So you can attract capital into some of the distressed communities. That capital will grow assets that will appreciate, and the tax revenues that come from the appreciated asset will exceed the original investment. Here's an opportunity for America to win, for communities to win, and at the same time, we have apprenticeship programs that will train the employees to work in those businesses. If there's a fascinating way to see reality in Washington, D.C., which is sometimes hard to find, you can look at these two pieces of legislation and those who have championed it, from Cory Booker to Pat T. Barry, who I'm sad to see leave Congress. Our country needs a shot in the arm our country needs champions who believe in the better future. I'm thankful that the Kemp Foundation represents an oasis of opportunity and encouragement and enthusiasm for those of us who are in the grind. Thank you for your hard work and dedication to this cause. God bless your work.
Thanks, Kemp.
Thank you, buddy. Appreciate it.
So every year we give a Kemp Leadership Award, and we're soon to announce that this year's honoree in December at our Kemp Leadership Award dinner is going to be Senator Tim Scott. So having, it takes a lot of courage to be a Republican. It takes more courage to be a Black Republican. And I know that my dad, who loved every opportunity to talk to people of color about why conservative policies were the best policies and why opportunity was best represented in the policies that the party of Lincoln should be representing. I know that he would be proud of Tim and his work and what he's done in South Carolina and for the country. We appreciate you coming by and talking Absolutely. About those pieces of legislation and the work that you're doing for all of us. So we'll see you in December.
God bless.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
So we're going to have a luncheon reception right after this, but we want to do one more story. We're talking about apprenticeship programs. One of the questions that I had for the senator is who's doing apprenticeship well? Who's training people? Who's doing the work of getting people connected to real job opportunities and helping employers who want qualified employees, connecting them to the skills that they need? So I want to welcome up to the stage Guy St. Justin. Did I come close to pronouncing it right? Say it again.
Saint-Just.
Saint-Just. Mm-hmm. There you go. So Guy is with Europe in D.C., and Guy, we're going to have our conversation, and we're the only thing standing between people and a beautiful day and some food, so we'll make it quick and Absolutely. Interesting.
Well, I was going to say, I don't informative. Know. This is the American opportunity, right? Between you and lunch, I stand, right? And so my job is to make sure that this is as interesting as possible so that you know what we turn like a risk into a major opportunity. So let's see how that works. So thank you for those of you who are still in the room.
So Guy, first tell us how you ended up at Europe. Tell us what Europe is mm-hmm. and tell us how you ended up there and your background and why it's a passion that I've recently learned about in getting to know you.
So first of all, thank you for having us here.
Yes.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity. How did I get to Europe? I think I am a product of the American dream. I was born and raised in Haiti, came here, sort of started my career bootstrapped and just grew through the ranks in the financial services industry. Parented two beautiful young women who are the absolute love of my life. And then arrived at a place where I wanted to have impact. And if you look at what's happening in the social sector, there is a movement of taking leaders, successful leaders in industry, and infusing them in the social sector. And so Europe gave me an opportunity to fulfill one of my dreams, which was to be the CEO of an organization. And it is the great privilege of my life to work alongside an incredible team of dedicated professional at the service of a mission that is trying at the very core of it, the very challenges that we have heard today, which is, for me, as an American by choice, the fundamental of this country, which are human freedom, opportunity, and those for me are the two that lead to the American dream.
So obviously we're talking about the new digital economy and how people are getting trained for the jobs that are changing. Talk about the companies who are the clients of Europe mm-hmm. And how it actually works and how those opportunities are being presented to the young people who you all are targeting to help.
So here's some data. I'm not really good at preparing for these things. So as I sat here today and heard some really good data, I'm gonna like mirror them back to you guys. I think Mr. Acosta just talked about the number two university school system in this country who graduates 67% of people in 6 years and another 66% just then goes on within a year to get a job at $25,000. That is the number two school system in the country. What we didn't hear from him in terms of data is what is the cost of debt that these young people emerge with to be able to get a job for $25,000, and then how long, as a former banker, I can speak about this, right, in terms of compounding interest, how long does it take them to pay off that debt? And so at YearUp, we come in to, at the crux of this idea of work and learn, and in 1 year, we will take a young adult whose average wage, you know, with a high school diploma, 18 to 24, who is earning on average $9,000 a year, train them in a six-month intense post-secondary education program, then an opportunity to learn through an internship for 6 months with companies such as Google, Facebook, Capital One, my alma mater, and you know the list goes on. And within 4 months of graduating the program, in your national capital region, our young adults go on to make $42,000 a year with zero debt. If that doesn't work, I don't know what does. And here's the challenge we're having, though. We just finished a piece of research with Accenture and Harvard Business School. And we looked at 26 million jobs that are currently posted. And we interviewed 600 business executives and found that a couple of data, 6.2 million jobs are at risk of degree inflation. Employers know that without any substantial differentiation in performance, that hiring somebody that would go to such a program would mean that they reduce their labor costs anywhere between 11 and 30%. And yet, here's the secret, 2/3 of them won't hire somebody without a degree. And the worst offender, I dare say, if you would allow me to say this in this forum, is in the National Capital Region, we've not been successful in placing young adults in jobs in the government. So this what you're doing here at the Kemp, you know, Kemp Forum is, like, this is actually the conversations we should be having, is how do we create public partnership, private partnership, to be able to solve a fundamental problem in our country that we believe if we don't address it, it will begin to do what I would call the greatest travesty in human history, which is to start to erode at the fabric of American ideals, because what we're doing is we're putting a barrier of entry into the American jobs, into the American dream. And that would be a travesty.
So one of the things I'd like you to talk about is I perceive that there's a culture of expectation in our country. I'm raising four boys, teenagers, and I think there's some part of it that's natural, but there's also some part of it that is getting ingrained in our society, that there's a culture of expectation. I should have this. I deserve this. How do you all raise the expectations of the young people who come in? And I understand you've got a pretty high bar. And can you talk about that? Because we want to go from a culture of expectation to a culture of aspiration. And I think the model that you all have seems effective.
Great. I think that, you know what, again, the idea of entitlement does not work very well with yours truly, and certainly not with Europe. I mean, we believe that the competencies of perseverance, I mean, I think sometimes people read Goldman's book about emotional intelligence and have made it like sort of a feel-good thing, but it's not. These are about the fundamental of what it takes to be successful. It's perseverance, it's grit, it's adaptability, it's coachability, which, you know, we've talked about in multiple ways today. And so at YearUp, here's what we do. We have for every young adult who gets a seat into our program, we've probably sourced through seven of them. And so they really,
sourced through seven of them.
Seven young adults. So for every seat, so if you think about our funnel, it looks like this. Because we want to make sure, we make our admission process intentionally difficult.
Right.
Because we want to make sure that the people who get in have sort of this emotional intelligence already wired into them. And then when they are accepted, go figure, we get 18 to 24-year-olds to actually sign a contract. And the contract is tied to a number of points, which is 200 for everyone, and it is also tied to their stipend, which we pay a stipend. We're paying people to learn with us. Every infraction known to man that you can imagine, and even some of them that I have violated, I would be like at 0 point and fired out of the program myself if I were like in program, because the idea of using your cell phone, or if a cell phone rings, that's a 15-point infraction, because we believe that there is still a sense of decorum and a way we conduct business in this country, from arriving on time to, you know, turning in work on time, etc. And so as they go through the program, at any point that a young adult arrives at 0 point, they're no longer in the program. So just to share some stats, you know, with you so you can see the funnel, in the National Capital Region, we are growing in the fall to start serving 400 young adults a year through two cycles a year. So if you think about 200, we'll probably source through probably 800 to 900 people. For 200 people accepted, we will end up graduating about 75% of them, because we'll lose 25% of them during the year. They won't make it. But here's where it really gets magical. 95% of the young adults, and so I will say nationwide, about 85% go on to earning about $38,500 a year. In our nation's capital, you know, we come from industry, so we sort of like are embedded with the ideals of best in class, you know. And so what we found is, like, right now, 95% of our young adults are graduating the program, are earning about $42,000 a year, and we have improved in terms of this idea of lifelong learner, of learning and continue learning and working. We have now tracked to improving from 9% of them continuing post-secondary education to close to 60% in just 2 years that have been enrolled in continuing enrollment in college, continuing post-secondary education. And in my alma mater, so I know Capital One really well, I was an executive there, getting people promoted, what we call off-cycle, you know, at odd time during the year, is quasi-impossible. With the last class that went through Capital One, four of our young adults got promoted within 4 months of arriving there. So we believe the program works. However, what it takes is for sort of how do we as a collectivity start to tackle this idea, or that ideals, that for someone to be able to perform in entry-level or mid-level skills jobs, that they have to have a college diploma as an entry point, right? And how do we engage in conversation in policies that says there are programs that work, there are programs that are proven to work, and how do we start to solve? Like, I think it is not only a national problem, it is a world problem. There are 6.5, you know, there's an enormous number of young adults worldwide that are not working and not in school. And in the United States, that's 6 million between the age of 18 and 24. And I think we've got to address this challenge for the well-being of our country. So, Jimmy, thank you again for having me here.
Well, thank you, Guy, for your work, your passion, the mentorship that you provide. I heard a bunch of the young people who graduated from your program a couple weeks ago, and they are inspiring. But again, I think, you know, having expectations is part of what we all need to be a part of in our civil society. You all are doing it. And then we also have to figure out how to reach the people who don't meet those metrics of getting into the Year Up program. Mm-hmm. And there has to be a stronger educational system. We've heard a lot of this stuff. The conversation is going to continue. The Kemp Forum on Expanding Opportunity Part 2 is in March of 2018. We believe we're finalizing the date, but it's this will be the second Kemp Forum on Expanding Opportunity, which is really talking about how to fight poverty. Our first one was in January of 2016 with Senator Scott and Speaker Paul Ryan talking to presidential candidates about their perspective on fighting poverty. We're not going to do presidential candidates in 2018. We're going to do policy leaders, political leaders, and folks like Guy, who have programs that are working technology companies who are reaching out and training people who need that opportunity. I want to thank Google and Lee Dunn. I want to thank Nelson Mullins. I want to thank Dan Bryant and Walmart. And in closing, I'd like Michael Beckerman to come up, and we should certainly appreciate the Internet Association's sponsorship of this, and Michael, your participation. Thanks so much for making this possible. Thanks, Guy.
Thank you. Thanks, Jimmy, and everybody from the Kemp Forum. It was an amazing conversation today. I think we learned a lot. This is obviously the beginning of a conversation and something that will continue. But a few takeaways. Obviously, the internet is a very data-driven industry, and so we talk about numbers. But I think when you look just at the numbers, it doesn't really tell the full story of the benefits that the internet and the digital economy bring to our country in every single state. We're putting out a report actually tomorrow, releasing data and some stories showing how tens of millions of small businesses and entrepreneurs across the country are benefiting from the internet, creating jobs, possibly as high as 10% of our workforce is benefiting from this, and that's only growing. But when you look at the numbers, it doesn't really tell the personal stories that we've heard some today, but as we travel the country from Kalamazoo, Michigan, and Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and communities across our country, it's the small businesses, often brick and mortar companies and individuals, who are able to create jobs and opportunities because of the digital economy, because of the internet, and it's right in front of our face. It seems very obvious, but we need to remember it and make sure that the policy stays up to date and doesn't slow things down. So again, thank you for the conversation today and the Kemp Forum for an incredible group of speakers, and Jimmy, for your leadership. We do appreciate it and look forward to working with you in the future.
Thanks, Michael. So we've got a great patio out back with a good view of the Capitol, and I think there are lunches. So thanks for staying. We appreciate it, and have a great rest of your week.